Hey, thanks for having me. Appreciate it so much. I'm really, really excited to be able to talk with you tonight. And I want to talk about the importance of carrying a concealed weapon. Did I get your attention on that one, Greg? Okay. I will come back to that, I promise you, okay? I'll come back to that, okay? And I'll explain what I mean. Because we are in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Since you were in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 last week, the text was assigned me. I didn't get so you'll see where I'm going with that here in just a little bit. Just a little bit about myself. I was raised in a very loving home. I was number 8 out of 9 kids. Good, strong Roman Catholic family, you know. Good Irish family. Lots of kids. And I really have no regrets of my upbringing, and we were religious. We went to church. I went to parochial school and all of that. And so I was religious, but I was lost. I didn't have a personal relationship with God. I knew about Jesus. I just didn't know Jesus, which is probably where some of you are. You can know about Jesus, but to know him is a different thing altogether. Okay, so I was a wrestler. I got a brother that's an NFL referee. Big sports was a big deal. I went to state in wrestling in 1976. So sports was a big deal to me. I worked for John Deere in Waterloo, Iowa, almost very shortly after high school, married my high school sweetheart, and started a family pretty quickly. As soon as I had a kid, I started thinking a little more serious about life. You know, I mean, you're holding that kid's like, I better get my act together here, you know. So my brother, number 7 out of the nine, had become a born-again Christian about 10 years earlier. And he was my hero growing up. He too was a wrestler and a really good wrestler as well. And so we were really, really close. And then when he became a Christian, he started talking to me about God, started talking about Jesus, started talking to me about what it meant to have your sins forgiven and have eternal life. And I listened, but I didn't want to listen too much. You know what I mean? It's kind of like, I'll listen, I'm not that interested, you know. Because I was just a party animal. I smoked a lot. I'm a 70s guy. I was a doper. I smoked a lot of marijuana. I mean, I did some of the other drugs, but marijuana was my light drug of choice, you know. Now that they've legalized it, it's not such a powerful deal, but whatever. So anyway, I basically smoked to get normal is what I did. But my brother shared with me, and I was working at John Deere during the shutdown period with a guy, his name was Nick. And he had a tattoo on his shoulder, and in 1982, they weren't all getting tatted up. I figured he was a partier, so I asked him if he wanted to smoke a doobie with me at break time. And he said, Pat, I used to do that stuff a couple years ago, but I got saved. And I remember thinking, oh my goodness, I got a word with a Jesus freak, you know. But I had a lot of questions by then, and so I started hammering him with questions. And every time I'd ask him a question, instead of saying, my priest says this or my pastor says this, he'd pull out his little pocket New Testament. No, that's not what this is. This is my bathtub Bible. I'll explain that too in a little bit. But anyway, that doesn't sound good, does it? Anyway, so he'd say, well, Pat, let's see what God has to say about it. And that really ticked me off. Because I'd argue with him, but I wasn't going to argue with the book he was holding in his hand. Because as a Catholic, I believe the Bible is the Word of God. We had a Bible sat right on the banister going upstairs. We dusted it once a week, whether it needed it or not, you know. But this guy actually talked like he knew God through the Bible and sharing Scripture with me and telling me how I needed to understand that I was a sinner. And sinners are separated from God, and the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You guys are good students here. And so it started to make sense to me. And it really did. It started to make sense. And then on September 6, 1982, I called my brother Mike up, who had originally shared Christ with me years earlier, got him out of bed about midnight, asked him some questions about prophecy, what the Bible says about the future. He answered my question, and then he said, Pat, I asked you a question a couple years ago. If you died tonight, do you know for sure where you'd spend the rest of eternity? And I knew then if I died in my sins, and by the way, if you die in your sins, guess what? You die in your sins. That means you go to hell and you go to a place of sin. Everything is sin. Unfulfilled expectations, desires, lust, you name it. Everything you're struggling with right now, you'll have all those struggles in spades in hell forever. So you either die in sin or you die in Christ. That's the only option you got. And so on September 6, 1982, my brother Mike explained to me the gospel, that Jesus loved me, that Christ Jesus died for me on the cross for my sins, for me. For me. You say, well, he died for... No, he died for me. And that's what I had to understand. That's what you have to understand. That's what Paul meant when he said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That's pretty cool. And so that night, sitting at my kitchen table, I just humbled my heart. I asked Christ to forgive me of my sin, believed that he died and rose again for me, asked him to come into my life, and he did. He changed my life. He's still changing my life. I still mess up, just like you do. But I have a different trajectory that I had then. I'm not sinless, but I do sin less. So that's my story. God began to change my life. 2 weeks later, I'm reading my Bible and smoking a bowl of weed. And for some reason, these two things just weren't going together real well, you know? And I read 1 Corinthians 6:19, which says, what? Don't you know your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who's in you? You are not your own. You've been bought with a price. So glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's. And, you know, I was addicted to that, and I just threw it away. God changed my life. And like I said, he's still changing. It's my joy to be able to preach this message to you, share my story with you, and take us to where we left off, 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Go there with me. And I have my bathtub Bible. So I haven't preached from this for years. It's got notes all over. I used to work at UPS while I was going to school and Bible college, and I'd get home at 3:00 in the morning, and I'd be all icky and mucky and yucky, and I'd get in the bathtub and I'd read my Bible in the bathtub, and invariably I'd fall asleep and go in. So my wake up, my wife would see it hanging on the where the towels are. It's my bathtub Bible has been baptized at least 5 or 6 times. But it's an NIV, okay? So if you got an electronic version, you can go there. It's the old NIV, so whether it matches up or not, I just think it reads a little more clear than the ESV in this particular passage. So I'm just going to read the passage to you, and then I'm going to talk to you about why you ought to be carrying a concealed weapon. Okay? All right? Boy, if the tape cuts off, that's really going to go bad when it goes viral. So here's what it says. By the meekness and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. I, Paul, who am timid when face to face with you, but bold when I'm away, I beg you that when I come, I may not have to be as bold as I expect to be towards some people who think that we live by the standards of this world. So Paul's basically taking on his critics right now. He is. P.O.'d right now in this passage of scripture. I'll be very honest. If you haven't figured it out by now, 2 Corinthians is a heart, it's Paul's heart. He's gushing forth in this whole epistle, and now he's ticked. In fact, if anybody thinks he sat down and wrote this whole epistle in one setting, 13 chapters, I would vehemently disagree with you. I think he put the pen down after chapter 9. Because chapter 10 is radical departure. Chapter 9, praise be to God for his indescribable gift. I used to use that on Christmas cards when I sent them off. It's a great Christmas card line. It's real short. You can get it in there. You get your pictures. Oh, well, anyway, so, but now he changes his tune. You can tell that his detractors, his enemies, the false teachers are saying he's not the real deal. Paul, Paul, big Paul, he writes the letter. He's big man Paul when he writes the letters to you, all full of threats and everything. But, have you ever seen him? He's just a little dweeb is all he is, by the way. They tell us he was not the most attractive dude. He had the unibrow and the whole nine yards. But, no, I'm serious. That's what they say. I'm telling you, look it up. Archaeology, not archaeology. They didn't find a picture. Yeah, they found a picture. This reminds me. I just thought of this. So I'm in this trailer up in Clarion, Iowa, and the leader, the drug kingpin in the entire Wright County, Clarion, Iowa, was there. I was in his trailer, gonna have a Bible study with him. We started over. He and his other buddy, who was right, his henchmen were right there, and I'm sharing my story with him, and I'm talking to Arnie. His name is Arnie, and the guy next to me, this is in the late 80s, he had long, greasy hair, and he looks at me and goes, "You don't like my long hair, do you?" Right in the middle of what I'm talking, I go, "What?" He goes, "You don't like my long hair, do you?" I said, I'm fine with your hair. He goes, hey, dude, Jesus had long hair. I said, "Well, okay, well, how do you know that?" He goes, "Well, hey, come on, man, I've seen pictures." I didn't even know what to say to that. Okay, so anyway, the point is, so Paul, and this passage actually gives you a kind of a depiction of Paul, okay? But man, I only got 25 minutes. How am I doing? Oh, I'm in so much trouble already. So here we go. I beg you, verse 2, that when I come, I may not have to be as bold as an expert towards some people who think we live by the standards of this world. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons, remember what I said at the very beginning? The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. They're not fleshly weapons. Or on the contrary, they have power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. And we are ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. You are looking only on the surface of things. If anyone is confident that he belongs to Christ, he should consider it again, that we belong to Christ just as much as he. For even if I boast somewhat freely about the authority the Lord gave us for building you up rather than pulling you down, and those are the kind of people we want in our lives, right? Those who build us up, not just tear us down. I will not be ashamed of it. I do not want to seem to be trying to frighten you with my letters, for some say, his letters are weighty and forceful. But in person, he's unimpressive. He's got the unibrow. And his speaking amounts to nothing. Such people should realize that what we are in our letters, when we are absent, we will be in our actions when we're present. He's saying, you want to know, you're gonna get a whole bunch of me when I show up. So I told you he was ticked. You just got to know how to read it. You got to have the right voice inflection, right? This is exactly how Paul sounded, by the way. Okay, anyway. So then he says, verse 12, we do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. When they measure themselves by themselves, compare themselves with themselves, they are not wise. And neither are you, by the way. We, however, will not boast beyond proper limits, but we will continue to we will confine our boasting to the field God has assigned us. Paul planted the church at Corinth. He says, I have some spiritual jurisdiction here. That's what he's saying. We are not going too far in our boasting, as would be the case if we had not come to you, for we did not get as far as you with the gospel of Christ. Neither do we go beyond our limits by boasting of the work done by others. Our hope, where am I at here? 15, thank you. Our hope is that as your faith continues to grow, our area of activity among you will greatly expand. I like that. I'm just tempted to launch into that right now. So that we can preach the gospel in the regions beyond. Paul is saying, I want to go beyond. Somebody just asked me about planting a church just seconds before I started talking. I mean seconds before I started talking. The guy right back there, our security guy. A friend of his thinking about planting a church, and I said, you can't really plant a church elsewhere unless your church is healthy, unless the area is healthy. And so Paul is saying, I want to go in regions beyond, but I'm concerned for you first, okay? So he says, for we do not want to boast about work already done in another man's territory, but let him who boasts boast in the what? Boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. Okay, so that's a chunk to take off. So Paul's in a fighting mood here. He's being falsely accused, the false teachers. You're going to hear about these false teachers big time in the next chapter when Trevor shows up. In fact, yeah, I mean, Yeah, I mean, I wish I'd have got next week's chapter, because I would have come after you with, well, Trevor will do it next week. So, but anyway, so he's calling them to warfare. You see that in the verses 3-5. He says the weapons of our warfare are not, they're not carnal, they're not fleshly, they're mighty in God. They pull down strongholds. That is really practical for you and for me both. Okay, so. Can you think of other scripture where we're called to spiritual warfare? Quickly. Ephesians what? 1. Ephesians 6:10. Okay, so yeah. So that's where he says, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand all the wiles of the devil. And he goes through that Roman armor. What's another one? 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul says, he goes, what's his famous line? Dick, what's his famous line? I've fought the good fight, which means by implication there are bad fights. Some of you, anybody here been in a bad fight? I just kind of figured. Not asking for any testimonies or anything like that, okay? But if there's such a thing as a good fight, there's such a thing as bad. He says, I've fought the good fight of faith. I've kept the faith. I've finished my race. And then he dies. Hey, that's a good way to go, right? To be able to say, I fought a good fight, I've kept the faith. Isn't that what you want? Don't you want to go out doing a good fight, not a bad fight, right? It is a fight, by the way, isn't it? It's a fight. It's a fight to stay sober. It's a fight to stay, keep your head clear. But it's a righteous fight if you know Jesus. You're fighting from victory. You're not fighting for victory. You're fighting from victory. Your victory is in Jesus. It's not in you. It's not in your wits. It's not in your smarts. It's not in your ability to do this. Everything is wrapped up in Jesus. You don't fight for victory. You fight from victory if indeed you know Jesus, okay? So if you're going to get ready to fight, you got to have the right weaponry. He says the weapons of our warfare, they're not fleshly. They pulled on, so he describes some of those fleshly things. That's like intellectual arguments. I mean, have you ever heard of an apologist? An apologist is a person who argues for the faith. There's a legitimate place for an apologist. But if the apologist is simply relying on his arguments, he's going down. We have to rely on the Lord. I said every one of you need to have a concealed weapon. What are some of our concealed weapons? Memorized scripture. Boom, shakalaka, pin the blue ribbon on her. All right, so that is, listen, seriously. Your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. So God himself has told us. Jesus said in John 15, you are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. There is a cleansing power in the word of God and the memorized word of God. It's like a spiritual bar of soap on your brain. It's not a guarantee, but it is one of your greatest weapons. If we had had the time, I was going to start in Genesis 1 and see if we could get a verse quoted from every book in the Bible. That would be a goal in life. 66 books, 66. Could you do it? I think you could. We could probably pull it together. Michael! I'm just kidding. I'm just going to make a point. So the memorized, I love what you said. You didn't just say the Bible, but the memorized word. So here's Jesus being tempted by the devil. And what does he do? He answers the devil's three temptations every time with scripture. And not just scripture, from the book of Deuteronomy. How many scriptures do you know in Deuteronomy? I bet you know this one. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God shall he live. That is a concealed weapon. It's truth in you. It's called the Rhema. My son, he's some of you know John. He named one of his kids Rhema. It's a Greek word, which means a specific word. So when you and I are talking, if I'm like this going, hey, let me show you a verse of scripture. I'll look up right here. That's okay. But how about me just looking right at you and giving you a word of God? Giving you truth. That's a weapon. I can't tell you, people. When I preached on Sunday, a guy came up and goes, Jesus, the God man, it just got me. He got saved right there. The word of God is powerful, right? Quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the very intentions of Robin's heart. That's what the Word of God does. And it's so you want to memorize Scripture. You can do this. You should do this. What else? Give me another weapon of warfare.
Prayer.
Paul told us that. Actual prayer, believing that you are connecting with the one true God through Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, right? So you come to the Father through Jesus Christ and you pray. It's a weapon. What else?
Accountability.
Okay, so how about, so you're onto it. Here's what I was going to say. People. So you need people in your life. You need community. So everyone here has some kind of community. We don't have any, nobody came here on their own, you know, unless your name's Matt Stewart. So that's the only, sorry, Matt, did I just call you out? But he's in a community, he's in my community group. And Matt came to know Jesus exactly 1 month ago. So praise God for that. Why don't you, praise the Lord for that, right? He needs community.
Amen.
I need community. People that speak into my life. People that speak truth to me, keep me on the cutting edge of my walk with God. We need community. That is a secret weapon. It absolutely, that's why you need the church. Don't think that you can do it on your own. Half of you probably thought that at one time anyway, right? Maybe more than half. Well, that was a stupid thing. Am I right? Because that is one of the secret weapons is the community of God's people. So thank you. And just, by the way, the Holy Spirit in you, being filled with the Holy Spirit. There's a connection between the Bible and the Holy Spirit. There's a direct correlation. I know this, that's because Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Then speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Then if you read Ephesians chapter 5, it says, don't be drunk with wine, which is excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. And then the results, same as being led by the Word of God. So being filled with the Holy Spirit, he's your ultimate secret weapon. So those are the things you gotta remember. These are not optional. This is not optional. You absolutely need that kind of weaponry in your life. The Word of God, the memorized Scripture, prayer, God, the community of God's people. And then, wait for the last one, a fruitful life. And he's talking about that here too. His life up against these false teachers, are you kidding me? I mean, we were in chapter 3, what's my argument for who? You're my argument. Remember that? He says, you're my letter of recommendation for crying out loud. You're known and read by everybody. Your life has been changed. And if your life has been changed, then you've been changed. And if you've been changed, other people will see it. It's the weapon, if you want to call it that, of a fruitful life, okay? So then, I'm answering the question, how to be ready to fight your spiritual battle. From this passage, you got to have the right weaponry. You can go to Ephesians chapter 6 to get more armor there that's listed, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, your feet shod for the preparation of the gospel, telling people about your testimony, the helmet of salvation, because that's where half of you guys lose your battle. No, about 98% of you lose your battle right here between the ears, right? Your head gets screwed up. And so Paul says, get on the helmet of salvation. That's a protective thing. The willingness to take disciplinary action. This is a big thing. Hardly anybody ever talks about this, but if you see verse 6, he says, I'm ready to deal with you. Did you see that there? I got to go back to it here. So how am I doing for time? Terrible. Well, how much time do I have, Dave? Real quick, seriously, I'm asking.
5 minutes.
5 minutes, thank you. Well, just believe me, it's there. So he says, he goes in verse 6, he says, and we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. So this is another reason why you need the church in your life. The church is the place where people are dealt with. They're loved, but they're dealt with. If you fall into sin, and you refuse to repent of your sin, the church will love you enough to deal with you. And sometimes that means you get kicked out. Not physically. We had a guy we removed from the church here about a year ago because he was a drunkard, and he wouldn't repent of it, and he was ruining his family, ruining his entire everything. We finally removed him from the church. And about 3 months ago, he stood before the church family. He said, "I've repented. I've returned my family. I've left the bottle. God's changed my life." He's back in. And you need that kind of accountability. You absolutely need it. Paul's talking about that here, okay? So, I had a lot more I wanted to say. However, just obedience. Paul, he's talking about his authority that he has here. And so, obeying your authorities, I'm going to guess some of you got in trouble because you just absolutely hate authority. Am I right? How many, just be real honest, you just hate authority? So there you go. All right? But yet God puts them in our life, right? When from a kid, you've had to have somebody answer to, right? And so God puts spiritual authorities into your lives. I represent that, but I have to submit to authorities as well. And so obey your spiritual. You want to be ready for the fight. Come under the authority of your spiritual authorities, and then boast in Christ, and let your fruit boast of Him as well. And we just talked about that. But in Romans chapter 15, verse 18, Paul says, "I will not dare to boast of anything except for what Christ has accomplished through me." Amen. Now think about that. A tale of two couples, and I'm done. Okay. A couple comes to me a couple of years ago. Their marriage was a train wreck. In fact, behind closed doors, they gotten divorced. We didn't even know they gotten divorced. And then they showed up a couple months later, they got remarried. Okay, now my head's spinning. Okay, you got married. Yeah, and pastor shows me a brochure. "We'd like you to promote our ministry that we have to struggling marriages now. We think we can help them out." They got divorced. They got remarried, and within 3 months, they had a ministry ready to go. Let me tell you something. "I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has not accomplished through me." We don't tee people like that up right away. But once they've proven themselves, the fruit's coming out. I said, "Look, I praise the Lord He brought you together. But why don't we wait a couple of years? Let's just work this out." No, they left. They took their wares and left. I don't know how they're doing now. The other couple was a couple that fell into immorality, and it was a horrible situation about 12 years ago, but we dealt with it at the time. We loved the adulteress was the girl, but I walked in the house. She was sitting in the chair. I walked right up to her and I hugged her and told her I loved her. And she would later say that changed her to know that I still loved her, even though I couldn't agree with what she had done. God put them back together. It's a beautiful thing. Almost 10 years went by, and one day I was preparing a message, and I said, "You know what, they're just doing so great." I called them up. I said, "Hey, would you be willing to testify what God has done in your life?" They said, "Pastor, my wife and I were sitting in bed last night, and we said, we should talk to Pastor about allowing us to testify of our faith." And they did. It's on video. Some of you have seen it. It's a powerful testimony. But we waited 10 years for that. I'm not saying we'd wait 10 years for you. Okay, maybe five. Anyway, but the point is, you don't want to put somebody out there until the fruit is remaining. And Jesus said this. You want to get out there and fight that good fight. You need what Jesus called fruit that remains. That's John 15, verse 16. You didn't choose me, I chose you, He said. And I chose you that you might bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain. When your fruit remains, you are one powerful weapon. Robert Murray McShane once said, "A holy person is an awful weapon in the hand of God." Are you holy? Do you know Jesus? Have you repented of your sin and placed your faith in Him? If you have, awesome. If you haven't, believe the gospel and then be a weapon for God. And Lord, that's my prayer for all these men and women, that your loving hand and your great power would be upon them to make a difference, first in their lives, their fruit would remain, and you would use them for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. And thank you for your attention.